and roll. Whew, that's the sweep. Everything from Bruce Springsteen to Iron Maiden.
Though heavy metal was an FM radio staple through the early 80s, few expected its riff-happy guitarists and pounding bass lines to thrive in the video age. In 1984, metalers had come up with enough hooks and more than enough kitschy looks to become Britpop's chief rival for MTV airplay.
There was punk rock, and there was bands like ourselves. Rat was coming out. There was a handful of bands. There was Wasp. It was as far over the edge as you could get, and it was real.
What do you think you're doing? Twisted Sister!
MTV allowed me fame, notoriety, and success greater than I ever expected to have.
What do you wanna do with your life?
I was a household word. The band was a household word.
I wanna rock!
For Twisted Sister, we woke up one day. I mean, of course, it happened gradually, but one day you sort of look at yourself and you go, damn, you know, I'm getting fan letters from girls who were 14 saying, my favorite bands are Duran Duran, Culture Club, and Twisted Sister. I'm going, whoa, you know, what's that all about? I mean, you know, I would have beat up Duran Duran if I had a chance. There was Twisted, and we were, you know, street urchins, bad boys, ugly, angry. But other bands were starting to smile. And the biggie with that, of course, was Bon Jovi. You know, the birth of happy metal.
Hi, this is John Bon Jovi.
Suddenly everybody found out that some of the bands had teeth, you know, big grins. And instead of everybody, you know, scowling and being pissed off, they were saying, hey, what are we pissed off about? We're making millions of dollars. We're playing happy metal now.
Shot to the heart and you're to blame. You give a bad name.
I picture more of what I'm doing as like Clint Eastwood with a guitar. You know, I got a holster, but it's got my microphone in it, you know?
With their mega-selling LP, Slippery When Wet, Bon Jovi joined a handful of melodic meddlers whose ride on the pop gravy train yielded multi-platinum results. Other bands sought immediate success with that crossover radio fave, the Power Ballad.
Child, dry your crying eyes.
Heaven is away.
Inspired by the flamboyance of the New York Dolls, Alice Cooper, and Kiss, 80s pop meddlers slid into spandex, slathered on the mascara, and dug out the industrial strength hair products.
This is how you do it. Of course, you dry it upside down, you flip it up, and then you just tease it like crazy, and you spray it as you're teasing it, each section, so it stays through a whole show.
While trying to maintain some sense of credibility with hardcore fans and reach out to new, largely female audiences, metal became fractured into subgenres. Some struggled to label the music. It might be metal, they said, but it ain't heavy.
It still gets me to this day how people think Rat was a heavy metal band. You know, because what, I wore a studded belt one night or something, and I mean, I'd rather go with the term fashion metal.
You guys have been labeled as being a glam band. Do you feel that the word glam is kind of getting tired, or they're not using the word anymore, or
yeah,
dying out?
It's that glam is more about image than music, you know, I mean, you can't call music glam, really. You call it look glam.
Is there a way that you would describe your image?
Glam.
And is there a way you describe your music?
Glam.
The 80s metal got very confusing because it went from Poison to Metallica, Motorhead, Ozzy, Motley Crue, right across the board. And anybody with a singer with blonde hair looking sweet and curly was called heavy metal. Now I don't see, I don't see there's any relationship between Metallica and Poison, I hope. Because, I mean, Poison, to me, were just an out-and-out pop band.
By 1989, the pop market had grown glutted with crossover-crazed metalheads. Some knew all too well at the time that the scene's days were drawing to a close.
It gets to a point
And I believe we're at that point right now when you get this kind of dinosaur music mentality going on, where everybody looks the same, everybody sounds the same. And we're getting into that again, which is everything that punk rebelled against in the 70s. I think it's time for a revolution, a musical revolution of some sort. Someone's got to do something original here.
When Nirvana came into existence, people saw how Kurt Cobain was, who was very just like, you know, normal, and they saw that he wasn't like some larger than life person. I think a lot of people were able to relate to that sort of thing more than, you know, this big glamorous sort of made up superstar rock star.
The reason Nirvana and Pearl Jam happened was because too many bands sounded like we did. You know, there was your Wingers and your Warrants and your Slaughters, and they were all following our sound.
All right, it's our fault. We were the band who brought down the 80s.
By 1992, the highly sexualized pop metal party had, almost in the blink of an eye, vanished. Fans and record companies had turned their attention to Seattle and a less frivolous aesthetic that owed more to the Sex Pistols than to Kiss.
When we released the record Cherry Pie, in the office of Columbia in New York, over the president's desk, Donny Einer's desk, his secretary's desk, actually, there was a huge poster of Cherry Pie, you know, and that was a big ego boost or stroke to the band to know that you're a priority at such a huge label. And then when we were going to release the next record, which was called Dog Eat Dog, I did the exact same trip to New York to talk with Donny. And over his secretary's desk was a huge poster again, only this time it was Alice in Chains' Dirt. And I was like, I think we slipped down the priority ladder here a little bit. And that was one of the very first signs.
Coming up, Dokken and Poison.
This is deep.
If you can't do it right, do it anyway. Boys and girls, you may remember this one. Thank you. It's nice to be here in Vegas. The lounge. But I'm not bitter. No.
What led to the decline of the interest in the music?
I think in any style of music that comes out, there's really, really great bands or originators. And then there's kind of the B copycats. And then it hits the C league. You know what I mean? Where it just kind of all disappear. You know, then, you know, every genre of music has just bands that come out that are originators, and then, you know, just, I don't know what the I'm saying. I don't know why it ended. I don't know. I don't know. I'm trying to answer genre of music. I don't know. MTV stopped playing the videos. I mean, who knows?
Every rose has its thorn.
As one of the 80's premier pop metal bands, Poison sold more than 17 million records and sold out arenas coast to coast. But that was a long time ago. Addled by drugs and arguing with the band, guitarist CeCe DeVille left Poison in 1991 and has since sworn off all controlled substances. Drummer Ricky Rocket dabbles in animal rights, rocketeering, and martial arts, while bassist Bobby Dahl wed and moved to Florida. As for singer Bret Michaels, once the high-profile paramour of Pamela Anderson, he's trying to stake out an acting career, having moved to Nashville to star in a self-financed film entitled A Letter from Death Row.
It's a little damn late for sorries now, don't you think?
Dad. You told me. If you leave, I got nobody.
The movie has nothing to do with music at all. It's completely, it's almost like a Silence of the Lambs kind of flick.
Public just loves to read about sick mothers like me.
I thought it was really important for me in the film to come off completely, step completely outside of what Bret Michaels has thought of as being a singer from Poison.
Poison's like the perfect imperfection.
Poison is like a circus coming to town.
Poison's a band for the people.
What do you think when you look back especially of the early Poison videos. What do you think when you watch them now?
I love it. I mean, I think, you know, I look back and that was fun. I mean, it was just so much fun. I think fashion is supposed to be fun. I think the way, you know, I think people take themselves sometimes way too serious.
In retrospect, it seems shallow, I guess, but it was a lot of fun. I had a lot of fun. And there's some sad, we had a lot of fun. You know, I mean, we had some good songs. We tried to delve into other things than just having a good time all the time. And maybe we really were having a good time to realize that we're not good at talking about the negative times. I guess maybe that's we're shallow. We're a shallow band.
What is wrong with somebody coming out and saying, yeah, I want to be a star?
When you start out, you kind of go against what was going on in your life then. And we came from a very industrial place in Pittsburgh, you know. And it was, and for us, I mean, we lived literally on the cement floor of a warehouse for 3 years. Part of music to me is as much escape as it is reality. You know what I mean? And I wanted to be glamorous. I wanted to go on stage. And everyone's always asking if you're trying to get away from that. And I loved it. I mean, I lived it. I loved it. And it was awesome.
The members of Dokken, the pop metal highlife, left them with a decade-long hangover.
It wasn't real sincere on my part when I went to what I went through in the 80s.
What do we look for in a presidential candidate? Big hits.
These days, chagrin guitarist George Lynch spends much of his time concentrating on his own chest. Back playing in Dokken after being in his own band, George has moved to a remote section of Arizona to become an amateur bodybuilder.
Wow. See, the reason I have to do this is because I have a 17-year-old son that wants to beat me up. So I got to stay bigger and stronger than him.
Our videos, first class crap.
Said she loved me, she'll come back.
Sorry.
Did it. You know, we still look at the pictures and laugh at them.
We became parodies of ourselves. Big hair, lots of makeup. Dokken failed miserably at being a hair band. We tried to tear our t-shirts, I tried to put the blue mascara on, I just couldn't get it together.
You know, if another band was wearing bandanas, darn it, we're gonna wear bandanas too. And if they were, what kind of hairspray is Motley Crue using? Aquanet Pink, extra super hold? Right, we gotta get two cases of that for the road, you know what I mean? We weren't setting trends, we were just following them. But I think musically, we were more viable than some of the other bands.
In hindsight, I think we should have listened to our managers more. Our managers went on to manage people like Metallica and people like that. And they always told us, just be yourself. You don't have to follow the trends in Hollywood. Wear jeans. And I said, you don't understand. This is what's happening. You need the fringe and the gold lame and the big hair. You know, you don't understand. You're just a manager. And then 10 years later, I'm a little embarrassed, you know.
What was the biggest mistake that you made back then?
I'd say subscribing to the lifestyle. I was compelled to create this false image that had to conform to the fans' expectations, and I've been able to let that go, and it's been kind of a healing process.
I want to run. When we come back, some 80s pop metal veterans tackle the big question: could they play? Many entertainers from the pop metal years have seen their lives of screaming crowds and endless tours come to an end. Janet Gardner, former singer of Vixen, now lives in the rural hills of Connecticut and has found satisfaction in the fairway instead of the fast lane.
Being in the music business, you get really used to people's opinion meaning something and mattering. I love going out on the golf course because nobody's opinion means. You know, you hit the right shots, you know, here's your score, this is what I got, I win, I beat you, nah, nah, nah.
Janet's not alone in her assessment of the pressures of rock and roll. Take former rock guitarist Warren DeMartini, who, contrary to all appearances, says he never enjoyed life at the top of the metal heap.
I wasn't very happy in the 80s.
The gigs were great, but the whole process wasn't very, you know, healthy.
Warren has since become a dad, and while he does still play music, he gets most of his satisfaction from being Mr. Mom to his two kids.
Marion, should we sing that song we were working on? You remember?
No!
It's just, you know, awesome how fast they grow, and I think that has it does something to you, you know, centers you.
Vince Neil, the Motley Crue vocalist whose offstage misadventures offered the era's most vivid example of 80s excess, also became a father. He continued to tour in support of his solo career, but found his life transformed by the birth of his daughter, Skylar.
I never wanted to go home, because I loved being on the road so much. But then, you know, when she was born, it was great to be home, and you know, you want to share in their life.
But that happiness was short-lived. Skylar was diagnosed with stomach cancer and died August 15, 1995, at the age of 4. Vince wrote this song for her while she was in the hospital. Brian Forsyth from Kix had no intention of wiping out his past as a metal musician, but considering the commercial state of the art, Brian's found another way to pay the bills.
I'm working for my brother, painting billboards. Today I'm going to take a bucket of white paint and I'm going to coat out this board, which means just paint it white. Then I'm going to paint a phone number on it and the word available. I did one for First Interstate Bank. It was like a big picture of a piece of cake on a plate. And that was a cool one. It's not the most exciting job, but somebody's got to do it.
Ron Keel has left the world of metal entirely behind and found his true roots.
Woo! My horse is a Harley. My gun's a guitar.
About 5 years ago, I walked away from all that. Traded in the beach houses and the sports cars for this old pickup truck, this flat-top guitar, a campfire, and a few country songs. Now I'm back where I belong. Western country.
The right to rock! 80s metal put the focus on image and lifestyle. Today, its veterans are looking to make a case for the musicianship they say critics overlooked at the time.
People put too much emphasis on the fashion in rock and roll today, because rock and roll really is, I mean, it is a way of life and a lifestyle, but the most important thing is the music.
What you hear.
And I've read album reviews on us, and all they talk about is what we wear. It's like, what happened, you know, when you talk about the music, you know, for at least a couple lines.
Do you feel that you were taken seriously as a musician?
Very much. Very much.
Part of the reason that we were so popular, I believe, is that we did have some respect musically.
Nobody is our competition.
There's no competition. Our,
if there's any competition for Rad, it's the super groups like Led Zeppelin or Rolling Stones.
I didn't think that they thought of us as a Beatles or a Beach Boys, you know?
Do you think you were taken seriously as a musician?
Probably not. Some people did, but generally speaking, people wanted to nail our coffin any chance they got.
The critics pick out who they like and don't like. You know, it's simple as that. If you're Michael Stipe, Michael Stipe, am I saying this right?
Mm-hmm.
Michael, if you're Michael Stipe, you get critical acclaim. If you're Bret Michaels, you don't. You gotta cut down.
Believe it or not, I went to NYU, I majored in music. I had Itzhak Perlman teaching me music. He'd be rolling over now if he knew, I mean, this is what I'm doing with it now.
Did you feel you weren't taken seriously as a musician?
Nah. I think you're as serious as you take yourself.
Hello, my cool little sugar day. How do you like my party?
I enjoy having fun, and I just felt that I did it as much as I can do, I guess.
Look at these butt knockers.
So yeah.
Ooh, let me tell you what I want.
It got to the point where it was like, okay, every rock band that came out in the 80s sucked, has no reason to live, and should not be on this planet, and there's no way they can possibly do anything worthwhile or viable in the 90s. So let's just burn them all at the stake.
All of a sudden, 1980s is the kiss of death. If you're an artist from the 1980s, now nobody wants anything to do with you.
Would you
Lita Ford, the heavy metal lust queen who duetted with Ozzy Osbourne in the 80s, is now married and living on the Gulf of Mexico, where she awaits metal's triumphant and, she says, inevitable return.
I think we got the whole family. I think a lot of people out there don't like alternative music. I think a lot of people out there don't like rap. And I think a lot of people out there want to hear just straight ahead rock and roll, and they're not getting it.
I did a good thing, I got in a fight, It ain't no big thing.
I'm definitely not done yet. I'm not ready to sit on my ass and, have lots of babies and sit around and be a grandma and all that shit. No, I'm not done. I'm ready to rock still. But the only problem is that there's no place for rock and roll in the music industry right now. Our rock and roll. Where the f*** did our rock and roll go? And I'm really pissed off about it. I'm waiting for it to come back and kick America into the behind big time.